Live from Dr. Henry Armitage Memorial High School AV Room, welcome to episode 108 of the Horror Podcast. My name is Tyler, and I run Signal Horizon, a magazine dedicated to exploring genre fiction in and out of the classroom.
And I'm Orin Gray, Monster Ambassador here at Signal Horizon, where I write and talk about monsters and monster movies and all that kind of stuff, just like I do everywhere else.
And always with a good recommendation for the episode, too, I might add. You've been spot on lately.
Good, anyway.
Well, tonight on the Horror Podcast, we're going to spend some time talking about what we've been watching and reading. We're going to help you find some free content on the internet. And finally, we're going to spend the remainder of our episode discussing the damn near perfect Halloween flick, Night of the Demons. As you might have noticed this season, yeah, I'm so excited. We've started talking about it before we even went live. So as you might have noticed, this season, every episode is going to be broadcast live, which means you can find these episodes by looking at our ugly mugs on YouTube, or they will regularly drop in your normal podcatcher like they would every day. But we would appreciate any kind of sharing or any kind of five-star review that you might drop on iTunes, or just a simple heads up, way to go, guys. We love what you're doing. So now, Orin, what have you been reading? What have you been watching? What's going on?
Well, since it's a minute from Halloween right now, it's a week and change still, but the way time's been going lately, it'll be Halloween in a second. I've been just started reading the comic book adaptation of Trick or Treat.
Oh, okay.
The Michael Dougherty Trick or Treat. They put out a comic book adaptation that's the movie, which is all the further I've gotten so far. But then they also did a bunch of additional stories, and they bound them all together in a hardcover that just came out for the 10th anniversary of the movie or something. So
that's very cool.
Yeah.
So how long? How many pages are we talking here?
About that.
Okay. Is that it?
So that's it. Yep.
Very, very cool.
Very hard to see the cover, but because the cover is very shiny. But yeah, it's cool.
So worth it.
Yeah. Like I said, I've only gotten through the actual adaptation of the movie so far, but which is cool on its own. It's always fun to see. I love comic book adaptations of movies, especially when a lot of times they're novelizations where they were made from the shooting script.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're different in these tiny little subtle ways of stuff that they either just didn't bother to explain the shooting script, or that they improv'd on set or whatever. And so there's these tiny little differences, which are always fun. So,
yeah. Well, and what I have found when I teach Zombie 101, we do a storyboarding unit because they have to film their own movie. Right.
Oh,
and,
cool.
The word storyboard is so unfamiliar to high school students, and also kind of freaks them out when I teach a little bit about it, that I just call them comic book, panes, mm-hmm. right? And we talk some about writing a comic to go along with it. And before we get anybody that tells me that there are fundamental differences, I understand that. But it's such a safer and richer environment to explore some of that in by calling it a comic. You can accomplish a lot of the same things. And I don't know, man, I just think comic book adaptations, almost anything are worth it. Hell, I read all of Buffy the Vampire Slayer season 8. Right. And I had to quit after season 8, but I was totally into those comics. That was the last probably real one I was into.
Yeah. I've got a ton of when Eli from Analog Sunday and I go out, back when we could go out looking for thrifting and stuff, we go to comic book shops and dig through the back issue bins looking for horror comics. And we've got a bunch of old from the 80s and 90s adaptations of, I've got Child's Play 2, I think.
Love it.
In comic book form, and Arachnophobia. Hellraiser 3, all this weird shit that they put out like an official comic book adaptation of at the time, and they're always good fun.
Very cool. Any anything else that worth mentioning?
I just finished up Clown in a Cornfield, which was great. I know you've read it before already, but it was fantastic. I was I started it, and I started out slow because I was busy, and then like I got into it, and I think I finished it in like a day and a half.
Yeah, it has that feel about it for sure.
Yeah, it was great. I loved it, and that's all I've been reading. I watched Prom Night 2 yesterday, which I know we'll talk about later on.
Yeah, that's a fun one, man. You know that.
I've never seen it before, so.
Oh my gosh! I don't want to spoil that later conversation, but totally.
Yeah, well, I saw the original Prom Night years ago, but I hadn't seen any of the sequels. So.
Oh yeah, there's so much going on with that too. That we'll save it for just a bit. So I have been doing a lot of stuff. I think when I was putting together what I wanted to talk about tonight, there's literally so much because it's Halloween, you know, like everybody's got really interesting content out. So I'm just going to highlight a few things real quick. Number one, one of our writers here on staff has a new novella, and it is about a big W weird lost episode of a reality TV show that's a lot like Survivor. Nice. It's so good. It's called Reunion Special. It's not super long, but if you like weird, then I think it is totally your cup of tea. And a new movie is going to come out next week. It premieres today, so technically like the embargo is up like 7 minutes ago. Okay, so it's 8:37. But the name of the movie is Murder, Bury, Win, and it's directed by Michael Loven. And the premise essentially is there is this new board game that is being peddled where you are essentially like a serial killer, right? Mm-hmm. And it has this wonderful sweet spot between horror comedy and thriller and a caper film. And it is just a ton of fun. I would say it's got almost a Knives Out aesthetic to it. It's not quite a whodunit, but it has that, I don't know, like the same mirth, right? The same, you know, joy in it that it's just a ton of fun. So it's going to be out on VOD next week. You absolutely need to add Murder, Bury, Win to your list of movies to check out.
Yeah, I should. I realized today that I've seen like 4 movies that came out this year. There were like 6 movies that came out this year, but
there are like 5,000 fucking movies, and the problem is
showing up on BOD. Yeah.
Well, and they get pushed out really quick, and we've covered a ton of online film festivals, which is great, and I absolutely adore all of that. But like, if I watch like a tenth of the movies offered at like Nightstream or, you know, a big, you know, online platform, you're still talking like 6 or 7 movies in a weekend, you know? And so like, I feel like shit because I watch like 5 movies, but there's so many others that I can't get to. It's like, oh my God, you know, I'll watch movies when I have to quarantine or whatever, which is pretty fucking fatalistic, but also the world we live in now. Yeah. So
But like apparently when it's an online film festival, it's so far anyway, like if it's the real film festival, right, that I have to physically go to, then like I'm out of the house, I'm physically there, I can't be working. And so it's like, okay, look, I'm going to have to take this day off. I'm going to have to watch these movies. I'm going to watch as many as I can in this day. Right. But when it's an online film festival, I'm always like, okay, I will totally watch some. I'm going to watch some this weekend. I swear I am. And then I work and then I don't.
Yeah.
And I keep doing that.
Well, and it's a weird balance, right? Because like, if I go out for work, right, I'm going to be out for work. And that doesn't mean that I don't enjoy it. I absolutely do. But I don't have the other responsibilities that hang out around the house, you know?
Right.
So like, I don't know. The kids will need lunch, right? And they'll be like, right. Well, shit, I can't start the movie before lunch, you know? Like, of course you can, yeah, you know? But
right. Well, and it's that thing again where if you go out, then you're out. You're stuck. Like you're there and you're doing it. You've got to make the most of it while you're there. You can't like multitask like you can at home. And then you end up multitasking away all the time. You would still watching a movie and don't watch anything.
Yeah. At least if you're... But I mean, there are a lot of really great things. So if you get the opportunity, then 100% you should take advantage. Yeah. We've got a number of writers that are covering things right now that they kind of sought out that fit that niche, right? Somebody's covering the Phoenix FearCon. And I like their platform a lot because you buy access to the platform and it's one new movie like a week, I think, until Christmas. It's $20, right? And there are a bunch of like other panels and shit that you can see that seem very cool.
That would feel a lot more doable for some people.
Right.
For me anyway, like it'd be like, oh, I can watch one movie a week versus like, oh, I'm going to watch six movies today or whatever.
Right. Yeah. Like, yeah. People just
which I would love to do, but have not been doing lately for whatever reason.
Before we run out of time for this segment, I do want to mention the big thing that I finished this week was Stephen Graham Jones' book, The Only Good Indians, and it lives up to every single tiny little bit of the hype that it has received.
Everything I've ever read by him, which I have not read this one yet, but everything I have read by him has been fantastic. So
I mean, it is satirical and really dark, and the monster is incredibly inventive. I think he has so much to say about being Aboriginal and developing a sense of an indigenous identity that I've always found really interesting. In fact, Sherman Alexie is one of my favorite authors. Granted, he's super problematic and shit now, but this is a horror novel written in his same voice though. And there is a basketball scene. Like my first love growing up was basketball. And this basketball scene at the end, if anybody else would have written it, it wouldn't have been as loving or as generous or as kind-hearted. But like you can tell he really likes it. And it fits so well in the horror narrative. It's pretty fucking awesome.
One of the amazing things about Stephen Graham Jones, like always, is that like... there is so much like warmth and affection and generosity in his, you know, in his writing style and then the way he treats his characters and everything that it makes the horror so much more wrenching when it happens.
Yeah.
And he clearly cares about these people. It's not mean-spirited like ever.
Yeah. Yeah. And even the characters that are deeply flawed, right?
Right.
He paints with such a delicate brush that their flaws don't ever define them, you know? And I just think it's really brave writing. And I don't know, man. The ending is fucking perfect. Flawlessly perfect. So I'd say the last 50 pages are probably the best 50 pages of a novel that I've read in the last 10 years. I mean, I was just... Nice. In so I don't know, maybe we can talk him on an episode someday.
We should. He knows so much about movies too. He'd be amazing on here.
All right, that's our plan. We'll get him for that then. All right, well, I think that pretty well takes care of what we have been reading and writing. So our dark corner of the web comes from Steam, and it is a free game. It's found footage, and here's the best part. It takes you 5.5 minutes to play. It's called September 1999, and the premise of it, I won't, you know, because it's only 5.5 minutes, any kind of description of it would, like, give it away. I will just say it's, like, found VHS footage. Nice. So, yeah, like, it feels like, I forget her name, but it's the unsolved mystery of... the woman who is looking furtively out of the elevator, and they later found her drowned in the water tower of the hotel. I'm sure.
Oh yeah. I know who you're talking about. I can't think of her name either, but
yeah. What it like it has that vibe to it, right? And obviously it's a fictional game, but like I was in and also That's scared cool. shitless. Yeah. So and it's free. So if you're looking for a really cheap, easy way to kill 5 or 10 or 15 minutes, also to increase your cred with your friends, because they'll love it kind of the same way we do. Check out Steam. Again, name of the game was September 1999. Okay, buddy. I think it's time. You ready to visit Whole House?
Yeah. every time I forget that it's called Whole House until I watch the movie. Like
yeah. Well, and I will forever remember it because there were these Christian haunted houses, mm-hmm. and they traditionally call themselves hell houses, right? For obvious reasons. But there was an ultra orthodox one in Kirksville where I went to school, and it was like they couldn't even say hell, so they called it Whole House, and it always made me think of this movie. So yeah. So let's start with our essential question, if we can. Our essential question tonight is Night of the Demons smut or sleaze, all of the above or none of the above? So.
A funeral parlor? Way out here?
I can't believe we're gonna party here.
Now it's time for party games.
Yeah.
How about a past life seance?
A seance?
What the hell was that?
They're pure evil. They're demons.
Okay, you picked this movie. Talk to me why. Why is this one, you know, coming to us at this moment in time?
Well, like as you said when we started the episode, like it's basically a perfect Halloween movie. It's like going to an actual Halloween party, except by the end there's like monsters and stuff. But like for most of the running time, it just feels like actually hanging out with the weirdos at the Halloween party. And it is delightful in that regard. I first saw it, I didn't see it as a teenager. I would have loved it if I had seen it as a teenager. It would have been like my favorite movie. But I saw it 6 years ago, I guess, at the first Nerdoween that they did, that the Nightmare Junkhead guys do every year. And so at the first one I ever went to, I saw Demons and this both for the first time. So I have a soft spot for it because of that and associated with Halloween, which makes sense because it takes place on Halloween. So
yeah, it does. And talk about things that feel good natured from the, you know, from the get go, you know, like it's just a great movie to see with other people, you know, I think plays well in a crowd. Has some really great comedic moments to it. So let's start maybe at the beginning. The one thing that I had completely forgotten that on the rewatch I was just floored by were the opening credits, right?
God, how can you forget those credits? They're amazing.
They really are. They reminded me of the aesthetic of like the Babadook monster.
Mm-hmm.
you know, the kind of weird paper cut, you know, like, I don't know. But I think that is the first, like, entree into this is going to be a Halloween movie, you know, like in those opening credits could be out of any like Disney, you know, in any kind of Disney Halloween cartoon, I think. So
yeah, and the great music too. Like I think the music is by the directors, a relative of the director, because they have the same last name, but it's great music. Like the score is fantastic for that opening sequence. It really sets the tone beautifully.
Yeah. And if you want a really great kind of takedown of each opening credit, what has quickly become one of my favorite websites to check out, especially in preparation for these episodes, is Art of the Title. And essentially what they do is they examine frame by frame the opening title sequences. And it seems like there's a lot of horror on there because, like, I don't know, horror movies spend a lot of time, especially older horror movies spent a lot of time kind of figuring out how to do this stuff, you know?
Yeah, like horror movies, broadly speaking, are more aesthetic than other kinds of movies.
Like, ooh, explain that one. I think so, that
like your a horror movie is going to be more stylized than a comedy or an action movie or something. Like, comedies and action movies by and large look the same. You watch most most action movies, most comedy movies, they look like a given era, but that's about it. For the most part, they look and roll out and are paced and everything similarly to one another. There's exceptions always, but there's not the amount of variance that you get in horror movies as far as like what they look like and what they sound like and what just like the stylistic approach to the movie is. Like, horror movies are very, very stylistic because very little happens in them, like, narratively.
Yeah.
Compare the average horror movie to the average action movie as far as like the amount of incident that occurs in it, right? Like, you know, a Marvel movie or something will have like 20 huge set pieces where they go to like three different planets or whatever, and a horror movie would take place over the course of one night in a room.
Yeah.
And
there are like four, you know, scenes of action, right? And right. The bulk of all horror is a little bit talky. Sure.
Right. And so I think because of that, partly, horror movies have relied really heavily on stylizing what they do have to give it, you know, atmosphere and tension and all that stuff, because very little actual event happens most of the time.
Yeah. Well, and the title sequence is such a great lead in to the action of the story, right? It right. is both cartoonish but also scary, right? And the designer of that title sequence is like his name is like Zabrinsky or Zelensky or something, but speaks really specifically to the aesthetic he was trying to reproduce was the aesthetic of Night on Bald Mountain, right? And all of that from the kind of spooky scene of Fantasia. And I can totally see that. And I think that's part of like why I'm immediately drawn to it. Cause I think horror junkies like us, like, see Fantasia and know that Night on Bald Mountain shit, and like that's our jam. I think everybody else is like, well, this seems odd, but I'm like, no, I remember that and I love it, you know.
I mean, it's definitely got both, like, that it's got that very you know, going to the witch's Sabbath, Night on Bald Mountain vibe in the credits for this, 100%, with the, you know, the little cutout demons flying through the air and everything.
Yeah it's good stuff. Okay, so I think any kind of discussion of this movie would be remiss if we didn't talk a little bit about the female characters, right? Because not only do they drive action, but I think oftentimes they're the ones that are talked about the most when it comes to this film. So we have Judy, who's played by Kathy Podwell, if I'm saying that right. And she's got like a Alice in Wonderland like vibe, right?
That's her costume, right? Like, she's dressed as Alice.
Yeah.
Like Disney Alice. Yeah.
Is there, do you think there's a bigger like a there's a bigger discussion that they're trying to have about Alice in Wonderland. Because I got 3/4 of the way through this movie, and I'm like, I can see it when juxtaposed with, like, you know, the other female co-stars, you know, like maybe as evil queens. I don't know.
I mean, I don't think they picked it by accident. I don't think that they're like, I don't think like heavy thematic concerns are on their minds in this movie. And I don't even say that to like denigrate it. Like, I think it is more concerned with other things. But I mean, yeah, I think, you know, I'm sure, like, they make a crack about it at some point, about her being Alice, like, to specifically point out that she's Alice.
Yeah.
Like, her boyfriend references it or something. And so, like, it's clearly not an accident, but I don't think it's intended to be anything very weighty. You can kind of apply an Alice in Wonderland thing to pretty much any female character in pretty much any horror movie.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's intended to be great shakes.
Yeah, she's kind of Alice is the original final girl, you know, in some ways. So I buy that. Well, and probably the imagery that I found most striking within that metaphor was at the end, the like crawling through the really tight tunnel, right? Or mm-hmm. the crematorium or whatever you want to call it, is vaguely reminiscent of the large Alice trying to get through the small door, right? Mm-hmm. When she's, you know, taking potions to try to figure out, how to get out, right? So I was like, okay, I can kind of see that, you know. I think it's mostly to present this like kind of innocent ingenue, which, you know, we fully get. Go ahead.
You go ahead.
I think it's important in any kind of discussion with her to also discuss, and you know me, I'm terrible with names, but the kind of the actress that you see thrown around a lot in terms of adding some really important stuff to the important scenes that we remember, right? The ballerina scene at the beginning and the kind of makeout scene towards the end is Linnea Quigley.
Linnea Quigley is the one who gets naked a bunch. Let's not beat around the bush. I mean, you know, it's her.
No pun intended. Yeah.
And I mean, you know, like, if you're me anyway, you know Linnea Quigley primarily from Return of the Living Dead, where she spends like the entire movie naked, right?
Right.
So it's kind of her thing. And you know, she's very game about it,
right?
And,
yeah.
which is great. And like, she has the most infamous scene in the movie, even if it's like kind of a pointless one, the lipstick scene.
Yeah, right. You'll see a lot of art, like a lot of the photos kind of highlight that. Yeah. So I think it, and I'll link to the article here. There was a lot of discussion because she filmed this when she was 29 and she was really reluctant to jump in and get involved because she's like, this is a movie about a bunch of high school kids, you know, like nobody's going to believe that I'm a high school kid or whatever. Like, in as much as I believe any of these fucking people are high school kids, right. I mean, she is.
You know? In as much as the people from like Scream were high school kids in their like late 30s, right?
Right. Exactly. Like, I'm not like, who are all those high school kids and their mother, you know, like they all look like they're definitely not high school kids. So, and I think, like you said, I think she's really game for it. She goes big in her scenes and has, it brings a lot of that fun that I think we've referenced to those particular to the particular scenes that they use her in. But yeah, like she's kind of a rock god when it comes to shit exactly like this, though, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, she's like a scream queen. She's known for horror movies. And like, part of what makes her good in stuff like this and Return of the Living Dead is like, it would be so easy for the way her character is treated in this movie to feel really gross, right? Like, it could really sour the movie, and her, like, her gameness for it and the way she plays it helps keep it from making the movie feel too much like Sleaze, right?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It keeps it from feeling like you need a shower after you're done watching it. It just feels good-natured.
Yeah.
Still.
Well, and I got to tell you, so I oftentimes will multitask, okay? So I was at school writing lesson plans, I don't know, a few days ago, and I hadn't watched the movie again to prepare. So I was like, all right, I'm going to put this movie on. I'm going to continue to plan, you know, but, you know, so I'm sitting there on my playing period, movie's playing, and I look up and it's that opening ballerina scene where she's like bent over at the convenience store. Yeah. Yeah. And I'm like, oh shit, this is definitely not, I completely, like, it's good natured enough. And even 14-year-old me, or whenever I saw it, you know, when I was a kid, had forgotten about all the kind of TNA and that kind of shit. Right. Mm-hmm. So I was immediately like, okay, I will watch the rest of this at home. You know, I was like, oh shit. All right.
Maybe not safe for school.
Right. Right. Yeah. So yeah. I immediately put it on hold and, you know,
it's definitely not.
But like, but it doesn't feel icky, right?
Right,
it doesn't
exactly
feel obscene. So,
and like, and again, it would be so, like, even it would be so easy for it to, especially her character, and especially
right,
what happens with her character, with her scene with the boyfriend and the whole lipstick scene and everything. It could feel so sleazy and exploitative and gross so easily.
Yep.
And you know, and as much as Linnea Quigley might not be like an Oscar actress or something, like her gameness for this material is what helps keep that scene from not feeling grosser than it is. And
yeah,
then the Return of the Living Dead scene, like scenes where she plays her character so gamely that you don't feel awkward that she's nude. Like,
yeah. Yeah,
you never feel uncomfortable about it somehow.
Well, I kept like in my mind, right? Like, I kept comparing it nonchalantly to like, Sorority Babes in the Slime Bowl or Slime Ball Bowlerama, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is definitely an exploitation film, right? Like, it
doesn't name, like, yeah,
right, right. Like, I know what to expect out of that, right? And then examining this film through that lens, and it's like, nah, I mean, I think this movie is really working hard not to be that thing, you know, like it is a scary movie that has some sexually suggestive stuff in it that has a little bit of nudity, but it's horror first and exploitation or sleaze or whatever, a very distant second or third.
Like, as much as I know it wasn't, right? Like, I joke that, you know, I would have loved this when I was in high school, right, or whatever. It feels like it was made by people in high school. Like, you know, as much as I know that these were adults making this movie, it does not feel like it. It feels like the movie a bunch of high schoolers would make, right? Like, it's preoccupied with the same things that these people would be preoccupied with.
Yeah.
Where that is sex sometimes, but it's also like pranking people and fooling around and, you know, like
drinking and drugs and shit.
Drinking and drugs and like getting into the occult a little bit, and like, ooh, we're gonna do a seance or whatever, and like, and that feeling. And again, this is maybe running counter to my earlier claim that this was not interested in like deep thematic concerns, but like, there's that feeling, at least when I was a teenager, like of wanting there to be more to the world than you knew. Like, you were, so I was anyway, so desperate for something bigger, something more than what I had experienced. And that wanting that, like, and that's why you go legend tripping, right? That's why you go to a place like Hull House and have a party there, is because it feels grander somehow, right? Like the legend of it makes it feel more real to you. And there's a sense of that in these kids who are probably not kids, they're probably all in their 20s. But I mean, you know, there's a sense of that in them, like in the characters of, you know, as shallow as most of them are, like they're here for something a little bit more than just fucking and doing drugs. Like,
yeah. Oh, sure. They could have gone to that party. They decided to come to this one instead. Yeah. Right, yeah. Well, that's it occurred to me, right? Because, you know, it's like very early in the movie that they're like, hey, we got the drugs. Hey, we got to have naked girls. And then somebody's like, now let's like summon the devil, you know, or whatever. Right. And they're like, yeah. It's like,
let's take a break from all the drinking and sex to have a seance. Right. Yeah. Like, yeah, exactly.
And there are two types of people, right? There are, I think, people like you and I, and probably the people that listen to the show, that would be like, fuck yeah, let's do a seance, you know? And then there are people that would be like, what is this, right? This is not what I ordered, right? And I just fundamentally believe that there are some people that want there to be something on the other end of that seance, and some people that are like, I ain't fucking with that. Which is fine, you know? Like,
I mean, you've definitely got people, and like Angela is like the extreme end of this spectrum, right, of our characters in this movie. The people who are like, I can do drugs and have sex anytime. I'm gonna have a seance while I'm in the haunted house, damn it.
Yeah.
What I came to the haunted house for on Halloween. I didn't come to the haunted house for shit I can do anytime. This is Halloween in a haunted house. We're gonna have a seance.
Yeah, absolutely, and totally be into it. Yeah, well, talk about weird comparisons, right? But I had no idea that this movie shared so much in its ideology with I'm blanking on it. Come on, the innkeepers, with the innkeepers, right?
Yeah.
Like, you have the people that desperately want to believe, and the people that don't. So.
Yeah.
We'd go look in the basement. Most of these people would go look in the basement too. So right on. So in their lives though, I think the fundamental question that they kind of ask as a throwaway line, and they discuss it real briefly, but I think it's really interesting. What is the difference according to the movie, and then maybe according to Orrin Gray, and maybe they're the same, who knows, between a haunted house and a possessed house?
So, what I found was really interesting is that, like, so Angela, like, explains the difference in the movie, or what her version of the difference is, what the movie's version of the difference is, and it is literally almost word for word identical to the explanation you get from, like, Lorraine Warren in the Conjuring movies, or even, the medium lady in the Insidious movies.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
Where the difference is that a haunted thing is haunted by a ghost, and a ghost is the spirit of someone who has died. So they're a person who's alive and they died, and now their ghost is haunting a thing. A possessed thing is possessed by a spirit that was never alive, which is a demon.
Okay.
So like their definition of a demon is a spirit that was never alive.
All right. I am kind of down with that. So does the movie explain, perhaps you can explain, how does, like, very clearly the rules for how a house becomes haunted are pretty clear, right? Like somebody dies in the house, there's a ghost there, right?
Right.
Is it that you have to have like a fucking Ouija board or conjure a demon or something for a demon to infest a house? If that's the
In most of the stuff. So like most of the stuff that I'm familiar with that uses this same kind of language, I guess, is like pseudo Christian stuff. So it's stuff like the Warrens, right? Who were, you know, the Warrens claimed to be like, or like not ordained, but like approved by the Catholic Church and stuff, right? And all this stuff. And so their mythology that they put forth is always very like Catholic tinged, right?
Okay.
But like so the Amityville Horror movie, for example, because they were involved in that, it uses a lot of the same language too. And you know, all those kinds of like supposedly true stories that the Warrens were involved in all use the same kind of language, and usually like the gist I get anyway is that basically these demons, right, are constantly trying to possess every fucking thing. Like they are just literally, and like, so my wife grew up in like far, far out there evangelical Christian stuff, right? And like, you know, the kind of thing where you get up every morning and you put on the armor of God, of the Lord, and that kind of shit. Like,
oh, okay.
Extreme stuff. And they've got this whole thing, the people who believe that stuff, that, yeah, like, you are constantly under siege by demons. Just, like, literally all the time, demons are trying everything they can to constantly possess you all the time, and you have to constantly be on guard against this. And so, like, by this logic, basically any fucking thing can get something possessed by a demon, like, the tiniest thing. But, like, a lot of the ways, and you'll see this in the Conjuring movies a ton, is that, like, as soon as something becomes haunted, it usually becomes possessed in fairly short order, because there's like there's a ghost, right? And the ghost is haunting it because they died there and they have this unfinished business or whatever. And there's a demon like right behind them using that to get a hold on the thing. So they will like, the ghosts will be being puppeteered essentially by demons who are like using their unfinished business to get a hold on the place. It's there in The Conjuring 2 a ton.
Yeah.
The ghosts in The Conjuring 2 are being used and deployed as like a tiny army by this demon, even though they don't know this.
Yeah. I think that's an interesting take. So, if I were to name you a movie, right? Do you think that you could say haunted or possessed? Or do you think that that's really a false dichotomy?
I mean, so most of them are both. Like, okay. Most of them are going to be like the Amityville Horror or something where it's both. There are, I don't actually remember if the Amityville Horror has both or not. The Conjuring movies certainly do. I've seen them more recently. They 100% have both ghosts and demons in them.
I think maybe Amityville's probably just possessed, because there's some allusion to the murders, but I think the murders exist, you know, kind of.
So the real story behind the Amityville Horror, to the extent that our readers or our listeners don't already know it, or that you don't already know it, if you don't, is like, so the guy, Ronald DeFeo Jr., the guy who committed the murders, his lawyer later claimed that he and the Lutz family that moved in later made everything up, and that they made it up together, and that they went into it together, and they did the whole thing together. The plan was that they would get rich and famous, and he would get a retrial for his client.
Not a bad strategy.
Right. So he claimed that, like, essentially the whole demon possession thing was a shtick to get his client off on the technicality that he was possessed by a demon at the time he committed the murders.
I mean, that's a pretty rad strategy. I mean, right. if I'm being honest, yeah, be bold, man. It is bold.
So within the sort of mythology of the Amityville Horror, right, which assumes that the story he told was true, then the demons prompted the first murders too. So yeah, I don't think it was ever haunted in that case. I think it was like demons all the way down.
Yeah. Poltergeist haunted, right?
Poltergeist, I don't think ever makes any such distinction, but yeah, I'd say haunted. Although you do get some weird stuff in the sequels, I think, about like spirits that were never alive, I think you do some of that in the sequels.
Yeah, there's all that, the weird shit in the second one.
There's the man in the black.
Yeah, but he was like a pastor, but and definitely the third one when they're in the fucking skyscraper. Like, there was some straight up demon shit in that, you know?
And I haven't seen them in so long that I couldn't tell you for sure. But I think it gets into some of that distinction in the later movies without really like discussing it. Because again, like when these movies were made, like not the country movies, but like these older movies, the Amityville and Poltergeist and all that, like when they were made, like this was public conscious stuff, right? Like the Amityville book came out and it was a big deal. And there was like big news stories about this and the satanic panic stuff was happening. And all this stuff was like on the forefront of people's minds. And so like movies didn't have to make this distinction because people just kind of uncritically accepted it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and it that you didn't have to build that audience. It already existed. So you just aimed your haunted house audience at this fucking new vehicle. And they were like, oh, okay. Yeah.
Like it was like splitting hairs between like a slasher and a serial killer. Like, what's the difference? Like, there is a difference, but most people don't care or need to know to understand the movie.
Yeah.
So,
No, I'm totally with you. Okay, so before we run out of too much time, I think it's important to go back to our initial question. Smut or sleaze, okay? So, smut is defined as grimy, indecent, or obscene. What do you think?
I mean, so I think it's trying to be both, right?
Okay.
I think it is, it's funny that you mentioned the Hell Houses at the beginning of the episode, because I think this movie is very intentionally being a chick tract, essentially. It's like it's thumbing its nose at all these like, oh, Halloween is evil, Halloween is satanic, Halloween's so dangerous. It's like, yes, it's totally all those things. Look, we're going to revel in how degenerate and demonic and dangerous this holiday is because we clearly love it. Like, it's clearly being made of a place of love, but it's embracing all those stereotypes.
And that gives it that kind of whimsy that we were talking about. Right. So I think maybe to approach the smut question, it can be both smutty, but also some smut can be joyful, right? Some obscenity can be in on the joke.
I think it is trying to be, and I think like, I don't think anyone who wasn't preemptively shocked by it would be shocked by it. Like there's nothing, there's nothing that's going to upset anybody except people who are already like preemptively upset about horror movies in general.
Right.
Like the kind of people who don't watch horror movies are the only people who would hate this movie for like being a horror movie, right? Like,
Nobody's going to clutch their pearls that isn't already, you know, like, oh, God, I'm watching Night of the Demons. Yeah. I think that's fair. Okay, so we lovingly say it's smut. Fair. All right, how about sleaze? Sleaze is defined as marked by low character or quality.
Again, I think it's trying to be. I think it means to be.
I am more comfortable calling it sleazy than smutty. You know,
And again, I think it wants to be. Like, I think that is the wheelhouse it is aiming for. Like, it is aiming for. I mean, because so one of the things that I come up that we haven't mentioned this whole time somehow, it's essentially Evil Dead, right? Like, it is one of the many, 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 many movies from the 80s that is essentially Evil Dead again.
I think that's fair.
It has some different trappings that make it more unique than some of the others, but like basically it's a bunch of people go to a building, all get possessed. I mean, you know, and
there's a disembodied arm in this case, right? but you know,
and like, yeah, it is clearly the aesthetic it is aiming for. That is clearly the wheelhouse it wants to occupy. And as great, genuinely great, I made this argument on Twitter actually that Evil Dead is genuinely great for various reasons. As it is, it's, you know, it's drive-in grindhouse sleaze. Like, it's not trying to be, like, we would not call it elevated horror or whatever. today, that's not where it wants to be,
right?
You know, Midsommar or Hereditary or whatever, like it wants to play in art house theaters, right? This movie wants to play on someone's VHS in their basement on Halloween night at midnight. Like, that's where this movie wants to play.
And it totally, so, like, it wants to be a double feature for, you know, a horror host at a small movie theater. Yeah, dude, that's why it plays so well in those environments.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah.
So is it fair to say when we're answering that essential question, it's all of the above?
I think so.
Yeah. And I think it's all of the above, but it knows that. And I think probably the important thing for both of us, at least in how much we have enjoyed the film, is it is both Smut and Sleaze without being exploitative, which, you know, I think is a really much more difficult tightrope than we probably gave it credit for.
Well, I mean, we didn't talk a ton, which is unfortunate, about Angela, who, like, is a fantastic villain.
Yes, she
is. To the extent that she's even the villain. Like, she's almost also the protagonist.
Yeah, well...
like, we spend a lot of time with her. And, like, she's great.
Uh-huh. Like, she's got that killer dance scene that is
Oh, my God, that dance scene is so good. Yeah. So, apparently, I haven't seen either of the sequels. There are two sequels. And then there's a remake. I have seen the remake, but I haven't seen the sequel. So every one of them has a reproduction, has a repetition of that dance scene.
No way.
Yeah. Apparently that's like her trademark as a character is that dance scene, which is amazing.
Well, both in college and, in my young adult life, I have seen a number of drag shows, right? And talk about a loving aesthetic, you know? The female characters in this movie have a drag sentimentality to the film that I think adds to the whimsy and the lovingness of how the movie treats all of them, you know, like it coupled even to the point where like those costumes, I think almost reinforce that type of idea. Oh, yeah. So that was the first thing that occurred to me with Angela is like she's a perfect kind of drag heroine, you know. Yeah. Like she's awesome in that way. So
and that dance sequence is really amazing. Like it manages to, like, in the space of a couple of minutes, go from like awkward to legitimately sexy to threatening.
Yeah
And it doesn't hurt at all that it's set to Stigmata Martyr by Bauhaus, but so apparently the song is different in every subsequent one. So like the second one is Morbid Angel.
Okay.
So the Morbid Angel song. And then the remake, it's Tape on Negative's Black Number One.
Okay.
I don't know what it is in the third one. So.
Well, I know in the second film, just from my research on it, second film was filmed on the exact same soundstage, like using the exact same haunted house. So. They're like, awesome. Fuck it, we still got it, so we might as well use it.
Yeah, damn right.
Okay, so as we have done lately, we have kind of a final segment here in regards to the movie, and those would be kind of movies that we think would pair well, or each of us is going to kind of pick two movies that if you like this movie, you should totally go out and check the other. So I picked... Prom Night 2, which I think is like a pretty easy one to like kind of go off of, you know, like it shares the same thing. And then by the director is Witchboard, which are a whole series of like Ouija board-esque movies that were made about the same time. I think Witchboard actually came out 2 years earlier, but it has almost that smutty, sleazy feel about it. Like there are a shit ton of like damsels in distress in like 90s and shit like that, you know. Like my 13-year-old self was like, why, yes, I will stay up until 11 and watch Witchboard 2 on HBO, you know. Like, but I think they work really well in highlighting some of the stuff that we've talked about tonight. So
and so, like, the Witchboard movies are great because, like, they're part of this, like, weird subgenre of sort of rubbery haunted house movies that, like, use a lot of wire, like, things floating around on wires. And so, like, there's just a ton of them from that era that are all kind of always fun to watch because they're very bonkers.
Yeah.
The Amityville movies turned into those after a while. Like, when you get into the, like... the cursed items Amityville movies from like four on, they're all very much like that.
Yeah, like, what is it, Nick of Time, or...
It, 1982, It's About Time. Yes,
It's About Time, that's it. Yeah.
That's the possessed clock one.
Right. Yeah. It's so good, yeah. Okay, so what did you pick?
So you picked, like, the two good ones. Like, you picked literally the two movies I would have picked. So I watched Night of the Demons, rewatched for the third or fourth time Night of the Demons to do this episode, and then literally the next day, I watched Prom Night 2 for the first time, and I was like, holy shit, this would be an amazing double feature. Like, these are so much alike. And so when I saw you picked it, I was mad.
Sorry.
But I picked Demon Wind, which is another one of the many, many Evil Dead alikes that came out in this time period. And so it's got that same thing going on and like a similar aesthetic. And then I picked Popcorn because, like this movie, Popcorn feels like going to an actual party. Sure. Like, watching Popcorn feels like going to a party in a movie theater. To the extent that Popcorn borderline doesn't have a plot, it does. But, like, it spends so much time with the people just hanging out in the movie theater and so little time developing its plot that it feels like just like hanging out,
which is cool,
which is great. Like, there's something very delightful about that, especially around Halloween, like around this time of year.
Yeah.
So,
well, somebody who did not find this movie delightful is our anonymous Letterboxd user. Our anonymous Letterboxd user left a 1-star review of this film, and here is what they have to say. This is disposable 80s horror. One of the movies you put on in the background, but don't necessarily sit down to watch. Halloween aesthetic, check. Practical effects, check. Will make you appreciate other 80s horror movies more, check. Were you trying to draw parallels to Alice in Wonderland? If so, that's cute. No attempt to do anything creative or different, though. The kills are just okay. It really needs more demon. I mean, really picked this one for that line right there.
Honestly, what movie doesn't need more demon?
Right. Well, and I in my mind, I picture him like doing a Christopher Walken, you know, voice, right? Instead of like cowbell, it needs more demon, you know? Just cracks me up. So, nauseating camera work, horrible strobe lights, they are very horrible, and dumb random editing. I mean, so I will agree with the strobe lights. The strobes are a bit much from time to time.
But I mean, you know.
That was what you had, and you used what you had, you know?
And again, you're at an 80s party, right? What do you have at an 80s party? You have fucking strobe lights.
Yep. But like, again, the reoccurring theme this season tends to be like Letterboxd users that say something because they think it denigrates the films. And we're like, yeah, that's why it's awesome. You know, it's like Halloween aesthetic. He didn't like that. We love it. Practical effects, not his favorite. We're totally down for. Will make you appreciate more 80s movies. Yes. Like, those are all reasons why we would probably rank it high. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, hey, to each Letterboxd user, like, again, I know this is like the third or fourth time I've talked about it, but if you just want to fall down your own Alice in Wonderland rabbit hole, fucking read people's 1 or 1/2-star ratings to shit that are really, that are really fantastic movies. You'll be like, oh my God, right? It's got to be like, I don't know.
And so before we wrap this up, even though this is awkward now, but I have to put it in here. So first of all, about the dumb random ending, like, it is super random. That ending is mad out of left field, but also like, it's very in keeping with the movies. Like, yes, Halloween is super dangerous and evil and Satan-y, right? Because like, oh yes, people are hiding razor blades in their candy left and right and shit, even though that never actually happened. And so like, it's very much in keeping with its like, we're gonna do all of that thing. But also, I forgot to mention this whole time, like, so a thing about this movie that is striking: the black guy lives.
Yeah. Oh, I thought that immediately.
Like, he is literally like, he and the final girl are the ones who make it through the thing. And so it's like, yep, totally just makes it all the way through.
Very progressive for its time.
Sure. I don't know about that, but it is definitely striking in that happens.
Yeah.
That was definitely before. I think that was even like a trope yet. Like, I don't think we had even like established that was kind of a thing that happened in movies yet at this time.
Or at least we're conscious or aware of it. Yeah. I kept expecting there to be a moment, right, where like he would sacrifice himself to save, you know, and I'd be like, here's where shit goes south. But no, man, like at one point, like he's like, he doesn't say it, but he's like, bitch, get your shit together and get up, you know, like get up this goddamn fence. I'm not saving you. Let's go, you know.
So he does, it's like, it's a climb, woman, or something like that. But like, and so an interesting thing without getting too much into the weeds here, but like, his character is very, so I watch a lot of movies from like the 30s and 40s and stuff, right? And the black characters, those are almost always this like cowardly stereotype. They're there for comedic relief, and their shtick is that they're super scared of everything.
Right.
Right. Yeah. They're terrified of everything that's happening to like comedic levels. And he almost feels like one of those characters, except that it's what saves him.
Yeah.
Right? Because he's like, F this noise. I am not going to stick my face in this stupid noise. Like, whatever idiot, dangerous thing you're doing, I'm not doing. I'm leaving. Yeah. Like, at one point, he just jumps out a window.
Yeah.
Like, he's like, what? Nope. Demons. I guess I'm going to jump out this window.
Time to get out. Yeah. Time to go. Right? Yeah, man.
And it's 100% what saves him. Like, it's why he survives, is because he's like, nope, I'm out.
Yeah. Yeah, it's good. It really is good stuff. And definitely the surprising part of the ending of that film. Yeah. Oh, well, I think we have pretty much had our way with Night of the Demons, Oren. Nothing much more on my end. Anything to add, do you think?
Just that, like, so both Angela and Mary Lou in Prom Night 2 both deserved to actually have a franchise instead of, like, the broken fragments of a franchise that they ended up getting.
Yeah.
Like they were really great villains, and like, it sucks that they don't have the same like cultural capital that like Freddy and Jason and things have, because they were fantastic, both of them.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I fundamentally agree. They are good stuff. Maybe we'll revisit some of those sequels later on down the road. So, Oren, where can they find more of your stuff on the web, man?
I am, as always, Oren Gray on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and even Letterboxd, where I sometimes like movies.
Yeah. You can find more of my stuff. I run all of the social media here at Signal Horizon. Or if you have a recommendation, if we got something wrong, or if you wanted to add something to this week's discourse, email me at tyler@signalhorizon.com. I'll read your comment, your email on the air, and maybe correct whatever it is we said, or give that audience that insight. Now, here's the important thing, everyone. Please make sure that you set next Thursday aside. It will be Thursday the 29th, and that day, Oren and I are going to live tweet using our Shudder accounts and our Twitter accounts, Halloween 3 Season of the Witch, which remains one of my favorites of all time. Another perfect Halloween film. What we are going to do is live tweet that movie, and much like we did for the Weird Symposium, we will live tweet it and then meet you right back here on this platform so that we can talk about that movie, a very special Halloween episode of the Horror Podcast. So,
I will talk incessantly about Michael Neal and how much he hates that he wrote that movie.
Oh, that's a tragedy, but also probably not surprising. All right, well, until then, stay safe, be healthy, and blast dismissed.